Hi everybody. So I'm a teacher. As you just heard, I've got a special interest in communication and complex communication needs. So students, people who use speech and who could benefit from alternative or augmented ways of communicating. It's just told me that keynotes quit unexpectedly.
Marvellous.
Was unexpected. I'm currently a lecturer at ECU, University, and I teach two new units. One is called Being an Effective Communication Partner, and one is called Literacy, Language, and Communication Law. And those two new units really came about as a result of considerable family leadership. And they're part of a brand new postgraduate certificate in education at ECU called Postgraduate Certificate of Education, Special Education in brackets, Complex Communication Needs. Four units. There are three compulsory units. Two are the two that I'm teaching, the two new ones, being effective communication partner, literacy, language, and communication for all. And one is a unit that's run by Dr. John O'Rourke, who I believe you may have had your opportunity to yesterday. Now, I just want to tell you the story of this, how this course developed and how it's maybe of interest and relevant to you, because it really wouldn't have been possible without the tremendous work of families, and it's such a privilege to be able to be here to talk to you about it, but also to run the course. So, in the beginning, it basically started in a wine bar in Mount Morley, which there were 2 months. Well, actually, there were 4 mothers, but I've sort of categorised only 2 of us as mothers. They were I'm talking about the 2 mothers who had children who had complex communication needs. There were 2 teachers, both of whom were special education support teachers, and there were 2 speech pathologists. And we were united with our passion for communication, our passion for universal access to communication, universal access to high quality literacy education. And we'd all been very inspired at different times in our careers by and life journeys, I suppose, by the work of the Centre for Literacy and Disability Studies in the University of North Carolina. And David Coppenhaver, who was the second director of that centre, his mantra is, David Yoder, who founded the centre, his mantra is, no one is too anything to learn to read and write. And that is absolutely fundamental to the way we teach at ECU on this unit, that there isn't a single person who is too anything to learn to read and write if we teach them effectively. And it's absolutely our responsibility as the teaching professionals to stand here and say to you, it's possible, and I just want you, if you take nothing away from this, please go away presuming competence and making the least dangerous assumption about your kids, because they deserve the opportunity to learn. And not everyone gets that. Not everyone understands that. Not all the professionals we work with get that. And I'm sure you've encountered professionals who don't get that. And I'm really, really, really sorry that that's the case. And I hope that with this course we're going to change that. So we shared this vision. And I'm sorry, I normally get emotional talking about it, but I am. I guess it's all been a bit of a big journey. It's really exciting to be where we are. And so really what we wanted to achieve is to have more numerous...
Yeah, how much that means to me as a parent.
That's fine.
But your passion is such a gift to us, and I think everyone else here is so incredibly grateful.
And I'll try and continue with that paper. Cheering and shouting with a lot of energy. Thank you very much. Right. So we want more numerous, more effective communication partners interacting and supporting the communication development and the learning of all people with complex communication needs. And just yesterday I read a newspaper article from Tasmania by a wonderful teacher, Leanne McFarlane, who is part of the group of professionals out there that get this. And she did an article about her school, and she said, I'm a bit obsessed with communication, but when you see work, you know why. And I thought, oh yes, that's absolutely right. And I can see another one over there who's a bit too. But so Jane Farrell and Sally Clennon, two other fantastic people that should be on your radar. Jane, they're both speech pathologists. Dr. Sally Clendon works in New Zealand at, I think, University of Auckland. And Jane Farrell is an amazing speech pathologist, and she has a master's in education too. And she works all over the world, but she does a lot of work in Australia, and she consults to a number of schools to help them develop really high-quality balanced literacy instruction for all of their students to make sure that everyone understands that all students, if they're taught effectively, can learn to read and write. And it may take a long time, but we can work along that journey to get them there. And they also said very recently in the Perth Winter Literacy Intensive, no one is too anything to communicate, and I totally believe in that too. And everybody at that wine bar in Mount Lawley was very much on the same page that night. And we just knew something had to change. And those of us that were working as professionals, we knew that, you know, yes, we were making a difference for the kids that we worked with, but it wasn't enough because we didn't teach those kids forever. We maybe taught them for 1, 2, maybe 3 years, and then they'd move on. And they didn't necessarily, the communication systems didn't follow through. There wasn't the support for families. We were working early intervention a lot, and we were putting a lot of work into supporting families, and then it just disappeared when they got to school age. And that's not how it works, you know? It doesn't work like that. And so we knew we needed something different and something big. And we know that communication is really, really important because, again, I just read this yesterday, Craig Woodfall is the principal of that teacher I just told you about. This is in the newspaper article from Tasmania. You can't have education without communication. How can any kid learn and express what they know if they can't communicate? You can't have relations. How do we develop those social connections that we all need? You know, we all see these deep social relationships, and we can't do that without communication. We can start them, and of course we're recognising multimodal communication, we're looking at every form of communication, but if we really want to connect, we need to have deep ways of communicating. You can't have everything, you can't have anything, and everyone has the right to communicate. So I just wanted to share that, you know, we're seeing this shift, things are changing. So communication, it's a basic human need, it's a basic human right, but more than that, it's a basic human power. Bob Williams is a gentleman with complex communication needs, and that's one of his quotes that's in our core text. So all of our students are learning that. Communication is a basic human right, and it's essential to our quality of life as a social species. We are social beings. We are built, the way our brain works, it's wired to seek social connections. That's what we need. It's crucial to our health and well-being, and they're crucial to our learning and our development. And because learning is a social process, and too often we're seeing kids taught in isolation. We're seeing kids taught things that are focusing on compliance. Schools, David Copenhagen mentioned him earlier, another one of my favourite quotes is that schools confuse compliance with a compliance behaviour with learning, and that's not learning. If we want anyone to be successful in any aspect of life, they have to be risk takers. You're not successful unless you take risks. So we have to set our kids up to take risks. If we only set our kids up to comply and do exactly as they're told in a set situation, they stop thinking outside of the box. They can't function independently and autonomously. And that's what we want, is independent, autonomous people who can self-direct their life and take control of their life. And so what we know is that social networks are really, really important to developing communication. And without social networks, and our social networks are limited without effective communication. And we know that if there are complex communication needs at play, it's not just the individual who has those complex social networks are impacted, it's their families as well. And so everybody's social networks become impacted. And so we have to look at how we can support everybody. We have to look at supporting the families as well as the individuals so that we can all have those big, strong social networks, because that is what gives us satisfaction in life. That's what allows us to function at our best, if we've got support. Okay, so conversely, if we don't have strong social networks, if communication is limited too, we're much better at developing our communication if we have strong social networks. And so if we have limited social networks and ineffective communication, we've got all these risks of unmet social needs, frustration, anxiety, fear, loss of control, learned helplessness, passivity. And of course, as I know many of you will have experienced, sometimes you know the behaviours that are the only form left to communicate, which can be very challenging to other people. And so we really, really have to look at solving this issue. And this is some of the discussion that we're having over our wine. And what we knew was there's just a shortage of professionals adequately trained in supporting people with complex communication needs through alternative augmentative communication. And you probably may well know that. There's a lack of community awareness and support to use AAC too. You know, Sarah Blackstone talks a lot about curb cuts, you know. We're getting really good at creating, I saw the photo yesterday, I was like, yes, the ramps, we're really good at putting curb cuts in place, universal access for physical access. But we haven't got to a point, we're starting to get the loop systems for hearing aids, and we're starting to see braille on packaging, but we're not great at communication. We're not seeing symbolic communication around, so people aren't really aware of how to use it. That's changing a little bit with iPad technology, and that's become more accessible, more and more people have access to these things, but still there's still not enough community awareness and understanding how to support it. And then of course the current service delivery models don't allow for adequate training and support of community members who could provide ongoing support to people with complex communication needs. And so, you know, I'm sure many of you again have experienced this, lots of support may be put into early intervention and then it just gets smaller and smaller as people get older. And you know, the service providers have huge caseloads, and with the best one in the world, they just can't possibly work in the way that we know people need to learn actually how to support other people. And so as a result, there was a really high rate of abandonment of AAC tools, whether they were high-tech devices, whether they were low-tech tools, they're just not being used. And so we sort of went away from this meeting thinking, like, that this is what we should do, we should maybe have this. What we really need to do is get some tertiary training. We need to think about how we can do that. So this is a little bit of a literature review. I think that might have fallen on me a little bit. You know, we found that, of course, our experiences here were reflected. It wasn't just a unique problem to Western Australia. It's actually happening all over Australia and all over the world. We know that people who are learning to use AAC do much, much better when they're interacting with people who are trained to use that AAC. We know that communicate when we are in an interaction, both communication partners take responsibility for that interaction success. We know that the quality of training of communication partners is essential for AAC users to actually make progress. And what we need is multiple, varied communication partners who can do that. We need a whole community of communication partners, a whole community who can support people with learning to use their AAC. And unfortunately, both family members and professionals alike describe multiple barriers in using their knowledge outside controlled training environments, outside the areas where they're specifically trying to teach someone with AAC. And you know, there's maybe their barriers of lack of knowledge, limited self-awareness and inability to provide ongoing support, a whole bunch of different things, and then also just some misunderstandings in the community and amongst professionals about how AAC can be used. And so, again, we just kept coming back, we needed more professionals, but we also needed community members to have greater knowledge. We knew that we needed to shift the focus from the specific deficits of individuals and think about it, the conversations that are impaired, not the interactions. And so we needed to put responsibility on the communication. Stop trying to fix the person with complex communication needs. Say, well, hang on, what is it that we're doing that's helping or not helping? What can we do to make this better? And so the idea came about that we needed this, need some tertiary level training, but we needed to be able to make it accessible to the whole community. One of the family members had links at ECU, Edith Cowan University, and we knew that we wanted to collaborate with existing local specialist services like the AAC services like the Independent Living Centre, and one of the speech pathologists was a current employee of IRC and one had worked extensively with IRC. And we also needed, we knew that we needed to collaborate across sectors. We couldn't just limit ourselves to one area. This had to be a whole of community thing. We also needed to ensure that there was an alternative entry to the course, so it didn't, you didn't have to have a degree in speech pathology or a degree, you didn't have to be a qualified teacher to do it. We needed more than that. We needed the education systems to be able to do it. We needed the support workers to be able to do it. We needed our family members to be able to do it, critically. And we needed everybody to be able to do it together, because what we know is when families and professionals work together, we can achieve really great things, because the families just know so much and have such a completely different perspective than the professionals. We're not walking that life. We don't know that life. We need to understand what that life is like and not come from a clinical perspective. And so what we ended up, sorry, I just need to check what time I meant to finish. I'm a bit, just to I really need to start at 2.
I think we're 15 minutes behind.
No way.
We decided, we managed to get a link with the School of Education, and the reason we chose the School of Education was, apart from our own link, was that schools naturally form the hub of a community in a way that today, day programs, hospitals, therapy service providers, they don't form the natural hub. A school is at the heart of every community. And classroom teachers have the most contact with school-aged people with a disability. 10 minutes? Okay. Day in, day out. The frequency of duration. So, you know, schools and teachers can't get it right. Young people with disability are going to be learning effectively, and they can't participate in that social responsibility. And we know there's a chronic shortage of speech pathologists in our rural and regional areas, but there's not a shortage of teachers, because the schools have to have the teachers. So again, if we can get it happening in the schools, then we can hopefully improve things, but we still wanted to make sure that we were maximising community, professional, cross-professional and community participation. So we wanted this whole of community training. And these were just some of the people that we were trying to target and saying, well, you should be able to include these and these and these and these and these. And the reason for that was basically because the more, Sarah Blackton has a lot of work on social networks, and we know that for people with complex communication needs, usually their most skilled communication partner isn't actually their preferred partner. It's not the person they actually want to spend the time talking to with, because it's usually the professional, and that's not, they don't always spend time all the time. So therefore, many people with complex communication needs don't spend most of their time with their most skilled partner. So we need to be able to work on that. I've made that point. So we started to get our the planning going, and again, we managed to work together with the families to secure, to submit a grant application to the DSC, and we had two new units approved. And so then we developed a steering committee, and within the steering committee, we made sure that we had this cross-sector representation. So there were parents of people with complex communication needs, friends of people with complex communication needs, but micro board members of people with complex communication needs, teachers, and not just teachers who already had ed support knowledge, but teachers who were working in mainstream schools who had never taught kids with complex communication needs, but really understood how, say, high schools worked and that sort of side of things, knew what professional development looked like, what good training looked like, speech therapists, occupational therapists, and not just those that were focused in disability sector, but those that were working in the health sector, those that were working in academia, and of course, and so that way we could really work together, say, what is it that we really need to do with these two units? We've got to give them really good impact. And so we decided, yeah, it had to be on communication partner skills training. We had to make sure that people doing the course came out as better, more effective communication partners. And we also knew that we needed to ensure that everybody left that course with a better understanding of how all students could be taught literacy. And that's critical, because communication and literacy develop simultaneously, they develop interrelatedly. We don't wait for one to develop before the other. And so if we're going to be empowering people to teach communication, then we should be empowering them to teach literacy too, straight away. Because there's no reason and why we can't work on both, and we absolutely need to, they support each other. So those are the two quotes I told you about earlier. So what did we find out that effective training looks like? Well, we know that it must lead to an increase in knowledge and understanding, a change, a positive shift in attitude, improvement in practical skills and consistent and appropriate use of knowledge and skills. So we have, that's a really critical bit. We want all these three to happen, but we also need it to then happen consistently in an ongoing way. And so we did a lot of work on effective training to see what do we need to make those things happen. So we know that we found out that, you know, we needed opportunities to explain the theory, to understand why we were learning what we were learning. They needed cognitive clarity. And we need cognitive clarity to get that positive attitude shift. If we wanted to improve practical skills, people needed to see lots and lots of models of those skills in practice. They needed to see strategy demonstrations. They needed to see hear a description of those strategies and see them in practice. Then they needed lots of opportunities to practice them. And that's often where our training and our PD falls down, is that we go to a 1 or 2 day fantastic, inspiring training, but then there's nothing else. There's no one to go talk to once you actually start trying to put it into place. So we knew that there needed to be this ongoing opportunity to practice. And there's talk about, you know, needing a minimum of 8 to 10 weeks of practice, needing to practice a skill at least 20 times within that time frame, and getting feedback. And there were two types of feedback. There was feedback on your practice when you're doing it in a controlled way, and feedback on your practice when you're doing it in a real, authentic situation. And getting peer coaching as well. And so with our course, what we try to do is to the other way was also a virtual e-community of practice, so that we were building up strategies for ongoing support. And so basically what our course looks like is that we're teaching different strategies, the students are having opportunities to practice those strategies in the classroom. We've also got it as an online unit, so they're seeing videos, they're practicing themselves, sharing videos, they're getting feedback on their videos. The students that are coming, doing the face-to-face units, they go away and they practice and they take videos and they bring them back, and then we have these community practices where they share and they give each other feedback. So they're learning about how to give feedback as well. We've given them tools to so they know what they're looking for. So they're learning how to give feedback to each other. And they've got sort of more experienced people giving feedback as well. We've got lots of the steering committee have volunteered to come and do sessions to help with that. And then ultimately, they're going out and they're skilled not just in their own practice, but they're actually practicing it across that whole semester. And I have the skills to sort of hopefully train and support other people too. And so that unit, those two units took 2 years to develop. And our first students and auditors enrolled at the beginning of this year. And so we have, we've got speech pathologists, teachers, occupational therapists, education assistants, personal support workers, mothers, fathers, friends,
grandparents.
Okay. All right, cool. Online.
I'm raising it. I've been doing it for 6 years. Grandparents haven't been mentioned today at all.
No, sorry, I'm talking about who's enrolled. Oh, you're enrolled?
I'm involved, I'm helping to raise this child.
No, enrolled in the course.
Oh, no.
sorry, so I'm just listing off all the people that are currently enrolled this year, sorry.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, okay, so that's who. So we've got professionals and who are doing the graduate certificate, and then we've got these auditor places as well. So the auditor places mean that the community members can attend everything that the enrolled students who are doing the postgraduate certificate attend, they attend. They don't do the formal essay, they do the group tasks. So we've got these group practical tasks, and the beauty of that is that we've split them up into mixed groups. So we try to ensure that each group has a speech team and a teacher and a family member, or if it's not a family member, it's an auditor who might be linked to a family member. So families have encourage their support workers or some of their micro board members to actually come along to the course, and then they choose a focus student, and they look at ways that they can improve that communication opportunities in their environment and strategies that they put in place. And so we encourage that they don't have to choose, but we encourage them to choose the family or auditor, the auditor member, member's known person with complex communication needs. And so it just means that there's this really rich authenticity to the task, and the family members are being, oh, it's just a amazing, you know, I've got all these, so much more ideas and so much more support. But it's really good for the students too, because they know that they're not just doing a case study, they know that it's making a difference, and they can see it happening. And then what we, and so yeah, so the auditors are doing everything that the face-to-face guys are, apart from the formal written essay. Online is a little bit different. Unfortunately, online we can't have auditors at this stage, and that's simply because of the way the course is delivered online. It's through the university's Blackboard internet tool, and you have to be enrolled to have access to that. To be enrolled, you have to be enrolled.
You can't do it as a mother online.
So at the moment, we do have three mothers doing it. I've got two mothers and a father who do it online, so they're doing it as fully enrolled postgraduate certificate. So two happen to be teachers, and one happens to have a degree in a different field, but because of her life experience, she's got enough background knowledge to start it. But it is there for a background postgraduate. So in our future, what we're trying to do is to look at other ways that we can do this to make it accessible to auditors online as well, because we know that there's lots of families who are regionally remote who really need support. Yeah, we know. The good news is that we've got lots and lots of teachers who are regionally. So we've got teachers in Albany, we've got teachers in Wheatbelt, we've got teachers in Kalgoorlie, Geraldton, and then we've got lots from over east, far north Queensland. There are people who are in remote locations and regional areas doing it, so that's encouraging. It's just the first year.
If your kids already left school and are in their 20s,
yeah.
I mean, you haven't got access to teachers, are
you? No. Yes, I appreciate that. And that's another reason why we're getting
That's why. That's why, as a mother,
yes,
I would like to do it.
Online, but you can do it face to face.
Because he's 20.
Absolutely.
So
yeah. No, we do have, on the face-to-face, we do have support workers and friends who are doing it as auditors of young adults,
yes,
with complex communication needs, and mother as well. Mothers. And so there is that room of face-to-face, but at the moment, just in this first year, and we hope to look at Jackie.
We were talking about, in subsequent years, if you can get a group of people together, so if it is in your community doing it, then auditors can join in with them. And that's about building some community capacity, so that you're not on your own navigating your own stuff.
Can I add to that? Because
yeah,
I come from Broome, I've got the same issue.
Yeah.
My son's started on the hog, he's 34,
yeah,
and he's been doing it for the last 6 months. To keep myself inspired, because
yeah,
I'm also learning hog,
yeah,
or an AAC.
Yeah.
I'm looking at something that I can do to keep informed, and I also have to teach support workers on a regular basis.
Yes. Yeah.
So if something could happen for
yeah,
parents to do something like this online,
and
even on a part-time basis.
Absolutely. Yes, sorry.
Have you ever spoken to David Cook at ECU? Because he comes up with all the solutions to the ECU technology problems like that.
It's not so much that, so you can't get access to
Yeah, I know what he's saying, but he could come up with an alternative because that's the type of problem solver he is. It's David Cook at ECU.
Awesome. All right. Well, yes, we will do that. This is great. And that's what I mean. We need this family involvement and ideas and sharing. And we know that at the moment it's not everything we wanted it to be. I mean, for example, in our initial planning stages, we wanted there to be three levels of access anyway, so that undergraduate students could do it too. They could choose to do these units whilst they were trained to be teachers and trained to be speech teachers, so they actually left with that knowledge. We would love that to happen. That's something that we're looking at whether we can do. There was a suggestion within the student group that we'd actually try to make like a TAFE level qualification as well, so we could do that too. But it's a huge thing that we've got as far as we have. This is the first year, and we definitely aren't stopping. So we will completely take on board some of those ideas, and we know that we need to look at.
Yeah. The other thing I was thinking, we have Notre Dame in Britain, which is a university. Do universities sort of co
do things together.
Because I know they've lost a lot of what they deliver over the last few years, and they might be looking for more strings to their bow of teaching things in the community as well. And also they're very Indigenous focused as well, which is another avenue.
It's coming to tell me to finish. All right. So I just want to say the last great thing. Well, so Chris Lennon, she's an amazing principal at a school, Willens Hill School. They have their own Victor's website if you wanted to have a look at that, just Google Willens Hill School. And she said that one of the biggest things from her was that real, honest communication between parents and school is key, as is trusting each other. And I think that's something that's really important. Yesterday I saw a question from the conference. It was something like, how do we feel about not having all the answers? And this was sort of my response to that. And I just thought, it's really important that we're aware that for many professionals, there's big professional insecurities about not knowing stuff. And I've certainly learned that the more open we are, the more chance we have of finding the answers. And but it's safe to do that and confident to do that. And I suppose that works both ways, but there has to be that trust and that relationship so that everybody feels safe enough to admit they don't know the answers. If you don't admit it, then you'll never find them.